Welcome home. We're so glad that you're at church and that you've chosen First United Methodist Church, where to gather and to sing praises to God. And we are just grateful that today God has given us this day, and we just get a chance to worship Him and to know that He is the one who created all things, and He is holy, and He calls us to live lives of holiness following His Son, Jesus Christ. Will you bow in prayer with me? Gracious Lord God, thank you for this day. Thank you for the opportunity to worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord, as we have gathered, we invite your Holy Spirit to be present with us today, so that today is not a show, but it is truly an act of sacrifice and worship. We ask that this time that we would share together this morning would draw us close to you, draw us closer to each other, and offer us opportunities to hear your word, to sing your praise, and to allow us to be transformed by that which the message you have to share with us today. Lord, we lift this day and this time to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
I know that I'm never.
Can Vicki bring me the paper? Go ahead, everybody have a seat. And a couple weeks ago, we had what we called our Grow One Sunday. It was our stewardship campaign. And Melissa served ably and capably as our stewardship chairperson this year. And she is happy to bring you the results.
Okay, good morning. What we have is a total of 39 households, which husbands, wives, single people, completed estimate of giving cards this year. A total of 24 of these homes increased their financial commitment above last year's amount. A total of 39 households filled out commitment cards on Grow One Sunday, which was 2 weeks ago, committed to a total of $129,496. Based on last year's giving records, which was $67,675, that can be expected for the coming year from persons who have established giving patterns but did not complete the estimate of giving cards. So this gives us a grand total of $197,171 in anticipated income for the next 12 months. Total income of the general budget during the last 12 months was $173,323.48. Next year, our income can be expected to be increased by $23,848.52. This is an increase of 13.7% above last year. Amen. So thank you very, very much for your prayerful commitment to this church. And I guess you could just say God's desire to lead us in His money. Thank you so much.
Awesome. Yes, thank you for your faithfulness, whether you choose to give a card or you just choose to put something in the offering plate. We talked about how it really is a way in which it's an extension of our worship, how we give. How we give to the church, how we give to our community. How we sacrificially give to our families and our neighbors and our friends. The sermon this morning was originally meant to be the stewardship sermon. We got all mixed up, and I decided not to fret because there's never a wrong time to preach about what God and what Jesus said in the scripture and what God has to provide in His word. And so the scripture for today comes from Matthew 22, beginning at verse 15. So let's hear about this altercation between the Pharisees and Jesus. Then the Pharisees went and plotted to entrap Jesus in what he said. So they sent their disciples to him along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance to the truth, and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then, what do you think? Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why are you putting me to the test? You hypocrites, show me the coin used for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. And then he said to them, "Whose head is this? And whose title?" Pointing to the coin. They answered, "The emperor's." Then he said to them, "Give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. This is the word of life for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
So, folks, we're in the first century, all right? In the first century, people paid all kinds of taxes. And if you look in a specific area of Judea and Israel, the place where the Jews were mostly living, Jews paid several kinds of taxes, all right? The big one, the biggie tax, was the tithe to the temple. And your temple tax averaged 21%. I'm not talking about a tithe of the 10%. I'm talking about the temple told you what to give, and sometimes that was an average of 21%. There were also customs taxes to take things across borders, and taxes on land, which would have affected more of the wealthy. So just like it does today, you know, people who can afford the land, well, they have to cough up to pay the taxes. The question of Jesus' opponents was much more specific, all right? So keep this in mind as we talk this morning. When they say, is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar, they're talking about a specific tax, and one that was obviously paid back to Rome, and Rome really did have control with puppet kings and governments all across the region. It was truly an imperially dominated system. All right, so Caesar was head of this domination system, and there were several different kings who claimed the name Caesar. And by the time you got to that point, you were considered divine. These emperors were considered divine by their subjects, or at least that's what they demanded of their subjects, to consider them divine, if that makes sense. Rome took control of the Jewish homeland in 63 BCE, and he ruled through client kings. And we know the names of some of these kings, like Herod, right? Because he shows up in our scripture, because we know that he reigned when Jesus was born. This domination system benefited the elites. And this was true almost throughout the world, that there were truly the haves and the have-nots. Wealth in the ancient world came from farms. Everything was based around agriculture. There wasn't a more diverse economic system. It really came down to, are people going to be able to eat and feed their families? Roman and native elites extracted about two-thirds of all the profits of agricultural production, two-thirds. And this came in a combination of taxation, you know, the people who worked the land, and actually the fact that they owned the land. So the elites were about 10%, and they got about two-thirds. And then the farmers, 90% of the people, got the remaining one-third, leaving them really to subsistence living, hand to mouth, literally, and sometimes even worse. And we see Jesus interact with some of these worse throughout our scripture. So you can think of those beggars that he stopped and listened to and touched, those who called out to him and said, have mercy on me. So we know that it got worse than just subsistence. So back to the taxing question. All right, so this specific tax, we believe that the Pharisees were kind of confronting Jesus about, trying to trap him in this question, was about an annual tribute tax to Rome. Once a year, this tax was collected, and all of these funds were sent back to Rome. Jews were kind of divided on this issue. You had those who were given the authority over the temples, and the Pharisees were a prime example of these. And in order to keep their positions, they had to collaborate with the Roman rule. They had to do what they were told, follow the straight line, and sometimes that deviated from the Hebrew scriptures. But they did. They endorsed the tax. And so if anybody came to them as the authority, they were told, pay the tax. Then, of course, there were Jews who were sympathetic to the resistance to Roman authority. This was an underground resistance, because if you either refused to pay the tax or you came out against this empire tax, it was equivalent to sedition, and the penalty for sedition is death. So there isn't an in-between way. You can't be a conscientious objector and not pay this tax. You either pay it, or you somehow go underground and hide yourself, because those are your only two options. Right, so Jesus is damned if he does, and he's damned if he doesn't by the authorities at hand. He responds. How many times has Jesus asked a question, and it would be real simple for him to say yes or no, but he doesn't. He sees many more layers to this discussion. And he knows what they want him to say. He knows that he will prove himself wrong according to, remember how they tried to butter him up by saying, we know you're sincere. We know you teach the way of God according to the truth, and we know you show deference to no one. So if he says, go ahead and pay the tax, he's showing that he isn't all he's cracked up to be. And if he says, no, you shouldn't pay the tax, well, there it is. The price is on his head. And although it seems pretty clear at this point that Jesus realizes that he is going to end up giving his life to the authorities, this is going to happen, it's not going to be over a trivial issue like the empire tax. So, how does he respond? So cleverly. He's always so clever. And his response allows us, I think, to go a whole lot deeper than the original question. So first, he takes a coin, and he says, whose image is this? Now, not all coins had the graven image of Caesar. And this coin probably had the image of Caesar Tiberius, and it probably also had an engraving on it that said, son of the divine Augustus. I mean, if you're a son of the divine, you're also divine. We claim that. We claim that Jesus is son of the divine, and we claim his divine nature, even though he came to us in the flesh, right? Whose image is this, he says. Some coins, especially in this area where the Jews lived, out of some deference to Jewish tradition about, you know, the Ten Commandments and all of this, no graven images, you know, shall be made. There were coins without graven images, but there were still these Caesar coins in circulation. Obviously a Caesar coin they're talking about. Well, of course they're going to say it's Caesar's image, it's the emperor's image on the coin. That's a pretty obvious question and answer to the question. And so then he responds, render to Caesar what is Caesar's, which could have been enough. That would have been a pretty straightforward answer to the question. But he goes on. Somehow they gave him a little bit too much time. They should have cut him off, but they didn't. And he said, and render to God what is God's. Render to Caesar what is Caesar's, and render to God what is God's. Now render, this word that's translated as render or give, it really means give back, as if it really belonged to the one in the first place. And then he's just saying, you know, if it belongs to him, give it back, basically. So, all right, there are lots of layers of meaning in Jesus' response. So I want to suggest two that you've probably heard before, and one that I think allows for this deeper layer of meaning. Probably Jesus means them all. But what's dangerous is sometimes when we use what Jesus says to kind of bolster up our own position. That's why I want to lift all of them up so we can, you know, be honest with ourselves about how we use the scripture to justify, you know, where we want to stand. Is he talking about separation of church and state? Give to Caesar what is Caesar's, give to God what is God's, then you have your secular and you have your religious. And, you know, when they meet, those of faith will celebrate, but if they need to be separate for the sake of the government, you know, I think that, you know, we can live with that. And we Americans, if we interpret the scripture in this way, we feel really comfortable with this because it is, you know, it's in our Constitution. It's part of who we are as American citizens. Paying tribute to Caesar, when it's appropriate to pay tribute to Caesar, you know, you go to your, you know, Independence Day parades, and there's a time and a place for celebrating that which, you know, we've accomplished, you know, in the world, and the freedoms that have been purchased for ourselves and for others is real freedoms. And then to pay the temple tax to God, maybe it's that simple. Pay your tithes to God, pay your taxes to the government. That's one response. I think that's probably the most surface answer we could get to, but I think Jesus might be even deeper than that. Now, many of you have probably heard a stewardship sermon where this scripture was preached and where the preacher comes out as saying, but everything belongs to God. He made all that is, right? He made everything. He made the time and the seasons and the days and the months. He made all of creation. He made you and me. He gave us our gifts and talents so that everything we make to him because he's the one who gave us the ability to have work in the first place, right? It makes sense. I think it makes a lot of sense to say that. It may be an unattainable goal, though. How many, like St. Francis of Assisi, who were born in wealthy families, would sell all they had because it all belongs to God and live a life of poverty by choice? If everybody chose to do that, then the economy would plummet and we would all die of famine, really. So we can't all make those choices. So it's not very realistic, but this scripture is also in this sense, if everything belongs to God, then some folks would use this, well, there are two sides, I think. It makes sense to anti-tax activists, too. They might quote this scripture if they want to opt out of supporting one or another government program. And this scripture has been used in my presence, maybe not from the pulpit, to justify people who don't want to pay anything toward defense spending, people who may be, conscientious objectors or something like that. And I've also heard folks claim that, you know, the welfare system is being abused and I don't want my money to go to pay for those things. So, I mean, it runs the gamut, but if you don't want to pay your taxes, you can proof text this scripture and you can say, all right, well, you know, I'm just going to give it all to God because, you know, I don't have to give it to Caesar, my government, because I don't agree with what they're spending their taxes on. I think that that would be a pretty convenient way of interpreting what Jesus is trying to say. Let's go back to the very first way he responded. He said, whose image is this on the coin? Whose image is this? All right, give it to Caesar. And when he says give to God what is God's, it harkens back not to the prophets who were ignored and people had to suffer the consequences anyway. It harkens all the way back to Genesis. Male and female, in his image, he made them. We, you and I, are made in God's image. Now, we may live in an imperfect world where there are emperors or governments or principalities that do things we don't agree with, who may oppress people, who make decisions that make life difficult at times and may not make sense. But ultimately, you and I are made in his image, and we belong to him. This isn't in a superficial level, sell everything you have. This means that you are his, and he is ours. With his proclamation, Jesus acknowledges that God's law allows what's imprinted with the emperor's image just be given back to him. But he also insists that it can be done in the ultimately more important context of giving what is imprinted with God's image, back to God. You and I were created in his image, and Jesus calls us to return to God all that we are and all that we have been given. We can give the emperor a coin or several, depending on our tax bracket. One day, when the wage is due, we'll have to pay it. But that's the extent of what he is owed, or what our government is owed. There is, however, no limit on what is due God, since everyone and everything is God's. Jesus not only models this life of giving everything to God, he makes it possible for us to do the same. Because of his trust in God's love and care, he willingly gave up all that he had and all that he was. So when we're trying to calculate our fixed rate of return and we're trying to figure out, well, is it before tax or after tax we're supposed to find our 10% to give back to God, God simply says, you are my beloved. You are my beloved creation. I have demonstrated faithfulness to you over and over and over again. I have given you everything, even my beloved only son. I have called you to be my children, to live in my kingdom and to participate in my reign over all the world. Now be honest, rather than living, and giving out of the abundance of God's gifts, we sometimes act like misers. We do, I do. We set our own limits to our own stewardship. We render to God the last fruits instead of the first. We calculate how little we can give back or give away. We plead to God. We're poor. We plead poverty of time and talents and treasure. We make giving to Caesar and everyone else a priority, and God gets the leftovers. We can be honest. So we, like the religious and political leaders of Jesus' day, we do stand accused by his word, because despite what we say, our actions declare we're not really interested wholeheartedly in hearing about the way of God, let alone living that way. So in the face of Jesus' instruction and invitation, it's possible to go away confused, confounded, discouraged. Like Jesus' inquisitors did, they walked away. They didn't even have a response but to walk away. Or we can turn and confess our sins and ask to be forgiven and walk in step with him. In each new day, we get to make that choice. God willingly gave up all that he had and all that he was on our behalf. He emptied himself. He humbled himself. And he became obedient unto the point of death, even death on a cross. And because Jesus followed God's way, God raised him from the dead. Through Christ's resurrection, we have been healed. We have been forgiven. We have been offered new life. By the dwelling of the Spirit within us, we have the power to live as Jesus did, to walk in God's way. And like Jesus, we can trust in God's love and care to give freely to God of ourselves, of our time, our talents, our gifts, our service, our witness, all for use in the world that God loves and cares for and wants to see the kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. Let's pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for the witness of Jesus Christ, that when he speaks, those who have ears can hear. And Lord Jesus, give us the strength that we need not to live as the world teaches us, not to have all the things that the world tells us we need to have to be happy. Allow us to hold your hand and guide us into a different way of life, one which leads to abundance, abundance of fruits and gifts, not that we may keep these gifts, but that we may also freely give as we have freely received. Gracious God, we thank you for your word. May it penetrate our hearts and transform our lives. We pray in Jesus' name. The praise band's going to come up, and as they play their next song, we invite you to freely give. We will take our offering at this time, and I just ask, let's see, Charlie, would you mind getting the plates? have a special offering we're taking today. At the end of the service, you see a basket on the table by the door. We have something we do at church called Friendship Feast. And this is a service we have for the community. Sherry Waltrop leads that service right now. And it's been a while since we asked the church for an offering, but here's what it'd be used for. The amount I put in the announcement in the bulletin is wrong. It'll cost about $800 for a new cabinet. With the one we had, the things are so heavy, it collapsed. The shelves collapsed. Thank God it didn't hurt anybody. But so we need a new cabinet, and anything we raise above the $800+ we need will go toward the supplies. You know, the paper goods and the extra food that we need on the Thursdays that we're responsible. So please use that basket. It's an invitation to you to give. And today wouldn't be the last day. If you ever want to make a donation to the Friendship Feast, you're able to do that. Just write a memo in your check, or you know, put something on the envelope that lets you do that. Potluck today at noon after the later service. I hope that you'll come, even if you haven't planned to prepare something, because that's our solution to the fact we don't have a fellowship hour. We at least get to do that once a month. And I wanted to let you know that we are doing care packages for boarding students, college students, and active duty military. We're going to assemble them on November 9th. It looks like we may have up to 10 folks we're going to be assembling packages for. This is very low tech. So bring 10 of something next Sunday, or either on the 2nd or the 9th. Bring 10 of something. Don't all bring ramen noodles, but bring, you know, you can bring pencils, erasers, you could bring, you know, ramen noodles, peanut butter, you could bring packages of
wet ones.
But there you go, wet ones, I was thinking hot chocolate. So that's right, wet ones would be good. So bring 10 of something, and we're going to trust, just like in a potluck, that God's going to have it all covered. So that's something that we'll have a box in both services where you can bring your donation. Send it out that, you know, the next day. So if you want to bring homemade brownies or cookies or something, just try to wrap them in bubble wrap. So that's okay. Gracious God, we are once again grateful for the presence of your Holy Spirit with us. May the peace of Christ go with us wherever he may send us. May he guide us through the wilderness. May he protect us through the storm. May he bring us home rejoicing through the wonders he has shown us. And may he bring us home rejoicing once again right through our doors. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace.
Brownie crumbs.